entrepreneur, multifaceted individual, art gallery owner from Detroit, Michigan, and now he can add author to his repertoire. Mr. Khalil Muhammad will be the upcoming guest on my upcoming episode of Real Reading Talk. Please stay tuned. Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Real Reading Talk. I am your most gracious host, Miss Sasha. And with Real Reading Talk, I discuss the real systemic issues that are at the very core, the very foundation, as to why there are low levels of literacy in the Black community and the ways in which we can combat these issues together. Yes, yes, y'all. Just like I told you, I said season three, I was dedicating this season as much as possible to talking with some awesome Black authors, okay? And I have been so blessed to be able to do just that. And on today's episode, y'all, I have a phenomenal guest, all right? This brother right here, he is very multifaceted, okay? So he is the owner of an art gallery. It's a healing center. It's called the Motivational Museum, all right? And an entrepreneur. So again, multifaceted, doing all types of great things, helping our community. And last but not least, he can add to his repertoire, an author. He is the author of the book, Meditate to Elevate. So I would like to welcome Mr. Khalil Muhammad to the show. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I truly appreciate it.
Yes, yes, definitely. We are so blessed to have you. We here, you know, Real Reading Talk honor all of our guests. And this is going to be, again, a dynamic conversation because like I tell all of my guests, this is not an interview, this is a conversation. So right. I want to literally just, you know, have fun with this, you know, empowering the community, you be able to let everybody know, you know, what it is, how you got started and everything like that. So first, what I always do, of course, is I want you as the guest, tell us about who you are, your background, Brother Khalil.
Well, I'm Khalil Muhammad from the city of Detroit. My background as far as business or...
Well, I always like to start with family.
I have two children, a son and a daughter here in the city. I'm a poor single man. And yes, that's pretty much it.
Okay. Okay. Well, with that, well, you know what? And I'm definitely, I'm glad that you started.
I'm like,
wait a minute. I'm glad you started with the children. Now, what I would love to do too, is I want our guests to hear about your upbringing, your background. So your, so who Khalil is, how did Khalil get to the Khalil he is?
Oh my Lord, have mercy.
Family, you know, the whole family upbringing. Yes, yes, indeed, because that is your foundation.
I was trying to get away from it. I tried, but she brought me back to it.
Yeah, this really we can talk.
So I grew up with a beautiful family and pretty poor neighborhood. We didn't realize how poor it was until, you know, we were adults, but literally adults, and going back to the house that we grew up in. I mean, had to be about eight to ten of us in a three-bedroom house, but it didn't seem that way growing up. But my family were readers. As you can see, I write, you know. My mom, she read a lot. We used to read Reader's Digest. They were all over the house. You remember that book? My family had a tremendous collection of it. So, and we couldn't stay on TV all day, so we had to read. Reading was like mandatory in our household. But, you know, and it was also a way to get away because right outside of our door was massive gangs and so much violence. And we couldn't always go out to participate in what was going on in the community because it was very violent. So we had to read a lot. And that's why I gravitate to it so much today, because I've done it my entire life, reading and writing. And you know, I used to write a little poetry growing up, and it allowed me to pretty much venture off in my mind. But yeah, it was pretty rough. But it was a lot of love in our household, a lot of love in our family. My great-grandmother, I had two great-grandmothers, actually. One, she died at like 103, so she lived walking distance from our house, and she lived alone. She was independent. She was really healthy, even until she died, you know, her time was just up. And my other great-grandmother, she lived not too far, and they were also readers. And I came from a family of many women, and most of the women were like very educated women. So they used to be on our head, you know, to just read and improve ourselves. But yeah, that's pretty much how I grew up. And I made some bad decisions in my life, very, very bad decisions. I knew better because I came from better. But just right outside our door was a different reality, totally different than in the house. So I went out and, you know, dabbled in some things that I shouldn't have. But I'm kind of happy because it's what made me who I am today, right? So I can look back at what I learned in my household and what I experienced outside, right? And it really, really helped to, you know, make a tremendous difference in my life, you know, especially when you really just analyze it and look at it. It's like, oh my God, you know, so that was a beautiful thing. It helped me really. I became Muslim through that journey, you know, dabbling in things that I shouldn't have, but I ended up finding Islam. Actually, a funny story about that is we're talking about reading. I became Muslim through reading the Quran in 3 days. And I had no intentions on actually reading the Quran, but just in the streets around people that I shouldn't have been around, I happened to bump into a Quran. So I don't always look at the misdirection or the bad direction that I took, because it led me to where I am today. Again, I bumped into the Quran. I read it in 3 days, and then I read it again in 5 days. But before I finished reading it, you know, I went from a very terrible youth, right? From a good youth to a terrible youth to a Muslim youth. And I've been that way ever since. And I thank God for my family and reading, because I was able to comprehend the Quran. Not just, I comprehended it good enough for me to embrace Islam, you know, without any assistance of Muslim dawah. And I was knee deep into the bad things that I was doing, like really deep. So people were really surprised when I changed over my life, because, you know, I was a very, very bad young teen. So a lot of people became Muslim behind it. But it was just, again, through reading the Quran and really comprehending what it was saying, it stopped me in my tracks. I'm like, wait a minute, what did that just say? You know what I mean? It was heavy. So I went, embraced Islam, and I've been that way since 17 years old.
Wow. Excuse
my rambling, but
no rambling here, because like I said, I mean, when I'm talking to guests, you know, when they get that insight into who you are, that is, you know, that is what I want them to hear. Uh-huh. Because mm-hmm. One, it just shows the authenticity. Okay. They need to see the real. They need to hear about the real.
That's right. That's right. And it's funny you said that, because I say it all the time. I say that sometimes we see our leaders with this costume on, right? And it's good to see them in their authenticity without that, so that it helps us, right? Because, you know, it's like, we have all this baggage, and we need to realize that so do they, right? And we're all in this struggle together. So I do like that, you know, just being authentic, being yourself. And that's another thing when I start reading some Black history books. And as I was reading my Islamic books, the Quran, and other books back when I embraced Islam, I also decided to read some books on Black history. And when I read those books on Black history, one of the guys, he said, be yourself. He said, it is so important to be your authentic self. And that's something that I carried with me all my life. It stuck with me in my head.
Yes, yes, indeed. And that's exactly, you know, that's why this is called Real Reading Talk, you know, because of the fact we know in the Black community, you know, when we talk to somebody and we want somebody to keep it real, we say, you know, don't sugarcoat.
Right.
Give me that
That's
real
right.
Talk, right? You know?
Yeah.
So I definitely, again, we, you know, the people who are going to be listening to the show appreciates you, you know, going into detail and talking about, number one, the fact of how you grew up around reading. That right there is, I love to hear that because
yeah.
That's one of the things, and that's the reason why I have this podcast, is because we find a lot in the Black community, and I'm starting with myself first. I didn't grow up reading. I didn't grow up around books. Yes.
You?
Me.
I can't believe it. I'm not going to believe that.
Yes, yes, definitely. I've definitely talked about this, you know, plenty
wow.
of times. Other episodes because again, people need to know who I am. You know, I didn't grow up in a house of, you know, I was.
I need to you. I need to talk to you. How did you grow up?
You know what I mean? But I did want to say that in terms of just making that, you know, connection, like, you know, being real, it's like, no, I didn't grow up reading. I didn't grow up seeing my parents reading, like how you said your mom, you watched her reading the Reader's Digest, and you come from this family.
My grandmother
and your grandmother, it's
she
like
a reading light on the bed.
Yeah, that's dope. Now I will say my grandmother, granny, she rest in peace, she did read the Call and Post. That was her thing, and that's what made me actually start getting the Call and Post as I got older. The Call, are you familiar with the Call and Post newspaper here in
no.
Cleveland? Oh, that's
no.
a black-owned newspaper that was owned by one of the owners of the Bustamante family, Brother Ansar. I know him very well. His father had owned it. Then they sold it to Don King. So yeah, but it actually
it was really big.
Yeah. But it was actually started by Garrett Morgan. He was one of the Garrett Morgan, Traffic Light. Yes. Yep.
Oh yes. That's so crazy. I just gave a talk on him at one of the children's schools. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So, you from Cleveland?
Hmm?
You live from Cleveland?
You know what? I know he's buried here in Cleveland, actually. He's actually buried.
Oh, yeah.
But I'm not. Yeah. I would have to research. I can't remember exactly like he was born here, but I know he's buried here. Yeah, so. But yeah, so with that being said, again, you know, that is very important in terms of just hearing that background. And I'm very, very happy to hear that, especially being a Black man, you grew up seeing reading, because that's the thing that we're dealing with now in the Black community. We have a lot of our Black boys who are not seeing that example. They are not around a lot of readers. And of course, Black children in general, but it's like it really hits when it comes to our Black males.
Yeah.
So, you know, one of the things that, you know, I just want to ask you in terms of, you know, what is something that you would suggest, you know, seeing as though you were raised in a family of readers, you were around reading, and, you know, obviously you're here because you wind up writing a book, in which we're going to get into as well.
Mm-hmm.
What are some things you would suggest, you know, to our community, you know, in terms of helping to get our young people into reading?
Well, I thought about that question. That was hard. That's a hard question. I mean, every young Black man is not a rapper, but I tell young rappers, I tell them, do you think Lil Wayne is that well-versed? He's reading books. Do you think Jay-Z is that well-versed? He's studying. It's impossible for him to articulate in that manner without reading. So I tell that group of people that, like, you're going to be a rapper, you want to study words, right? You want to learn how to use words, right? And but everybody's not trying to be a rapper or a singer. So that's a very difficult question. So my editor asked me the same thing. And I'm like, I want to market to them, but they're asking me to explain how. And I can't, because it is a very deep situation. My thing is I'm putting the boots on the ground. That's all I can tell you. I'm putting the boots on the ground and go to your face, right? And just do it that way. I mean, because they have so much that's challenging them, that's taken away their attention, for them to sit down and be present, right? So to get them to read, that's possible. That's why I wrote this book. You know, they switched it up to my book for college students or, you know, or professionals. But originally, to keep it 100, as you would say, I wanted to market mine for the boy on the block in front of the liquor store or you know, wherever, you know, at the concert, at the club, you know, because I wanted them to see this information that would help transform their lives, right? And reading is just so powerful. But again, I think it's possible. I'm going to try. But to get them to sit down, I think we got to go back first to getting them to sit down, right? Getting them to be present. I think it's a whole a step-by-step process, right, to get them there. I think it's not just getting them to read. We got to sit them down, get them focused. You're talking about these people, our minds are everywhere. They got TikTok, Facebook, Instagram, this, that. All of the chaos going on in the world, household not stable. It's possible, but I think it's a whole step-by-step process.
Mm-hmm.
Did it make sense? Am I making sense?
It makes a perfect sense. And what I actually was going to ask you about, because obviously we are in this technology space,
mm-hmm.
with the age of audiobooks, all right? So mm-hmm. that is something... You know, like even yeah. parents, I tell them, the parents of my students that I tutor, you know, I let them know, I say, if you do not have time to read for at least 30 minutes a day to your child, then you can actually go on YouTube, you know, and then I tell them, I say, hey, you can go to my YouTube channel, listen to Read Aloud. You can go to, there's a plethora. You know what I mean? There's different ways in which they can get that reading in. And also, I know people were talking about too, in terms of, just even like with the texting, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, even I guess somebody has suggested like maybe putting little like snippets of like passages, not something long, because that's, again, we're dealing with the short attention span, okay? So for them to like even wanting to sit down with a book seems daunting to them. They're like, oh my God, man, that's just like a straight up just crazy task, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So,
you know, doing little passages. Someone had suggested that to me. What do you think about that? Like those types of ideas?
You know, I don't know what it's called, and I hope I don't make, I hope you edit this out, and I hope I don't make a fool of myself. But I was just at a library, Brother Khalid, and this lady was showing me a book. I don't know if she said, I feel like she said it's been out, but it's pictures. They read through pictures. Have you saw those? What is the right terminology? Okay, me and you in the same boat.
Wait, so you then, it's wordless books, just pictures.
It's a big thing.
Yeah,
what is that called?
You know what? I don't know, but you keep talking about that, and I'm going to just Google it. Google it real quick.
I was at the library at Brother Dr. College, one of his events, and you know, I was talking about reading as you're speaking with me now, and how, you know, basically getting people to read more or whatever. And she showed me this book. They have a whole section in the library where it's art, and you can just you read that way. And if you really think about it, that's the way we used to read a long time ago. Now, you won't get far today doing that, because the society is not set up that way. But we have to start somewhere with people, right? And so, yeah, anything, you know, me, Like, again, I'm just going to run up on them with the book. Like, bro, read this. You need to check this out. Make sure I'm looking good. You know what I'm saying? Check it out, bro. This can help solve a problem in your life. Are you tired of dealing with that? Do you have an answer for that? Bro, at least read this chapter.
Yep.
Read this chapter. Don't read the whole book. Just read a chapter. And you have to start with them just little bitty things at a time. You have to be, as you said, we have to keep it real. We have to keep it real with that as well. Just a little bit. And once they get in, because reading, as you know, it's like an exercise. So you're exercising those frontal lobes. You're exercising different components in your brain, right? You're telling that brain to pay attention, and it hasn't paid attention. It has all kind of bad food inside of it. It's anxiety. It's going everywhere. It's crazy, like the monks call it, the monkey mind. So we're asking them to do something that hurts, right? It's uncomfortable. So we ask them just a little bit at a time. Read this, you know, Grant Cardone. He don't write books this size. He doesn't write books this size. He don't write books this size. He writes them like few pages, okay. 30 pages. You know what I mean? So we got to start them with little stuff like that. You know, read this 30 pager. And again, it's just like going to the gym. So the more you do it, the brain is actually doing what's called neuroplasticity. It's actually expanding, making it even possible, right, for this person to facilitate the activity of reading. So we can't just give, you know, this guy this book. We can give it, but it's just like being in a gym. We got to show them how to work out. Bro, just read a chapter, then I'll call you. You know what I'm saying? Let's talk about that chapter. And the more we get them excited about it, like, whoa, that was deep. Now we're making room. We're making room. We're creating neural pathways in his mind so that he can go further, right? But if we don't create those, what they call neural pathways, or help him create it or help her create it for themselves, then it's going to be a very difficult task. Am I making sense?
No, you're making perfect sense, because actually a thought in my head, my sister, she had listened to one of my podcasts, my dope sister, shout out to Bip Veronica. And so she had gave me some advice. She was like, you know what I think you should do? She said, especially because the audience that you are talking to, of course, I'm talking to people who are educated, but also one of my target audiences are those who may not know what to do, how to get their kids into reading. And she literally had mentioned pretty much kind of something what you said. She said, I could even talk about like one of the books that I've read, because that's how I usually end the podcast. I'll talk about the book that I'm currently reading. And she said, you could suggest that book and also maybe highlight a chapter or two in there and let it know, like, okay, you know what? I want you to look for these key things that I read in this chapter. You tell me, give me some feedback. So I'm letting them know, yes, I want you to be able to engage with me about this particular book. I'm suggesting that you read. So what it sounds like, what you're saying, Khalil, just like what my sister was telling me, is that we got to do a lot of hand holding.
Come on. Yeah. And I like what you just said about highlighting. And I'm gonna articulate an idea that I haven't put together all the way in my head as you were talking. If you were to develop, because it's all our responsibility, right? And we were to develop something, like you say, you highlighted it. Maybe you highlight all the important parts of that chapter where you don't have to read everything. And like you said, you're giving them baby steps. And once they do that, we go and we get the goody-goody out of it, right? You know, you need to read this. Or depending upon if we're teaching a child, we want to find the things that relate to that child, those key points. We want to underline those. You don't have to read the whole book. Just read this. It's a lot of work. You know what I mean? But you got to imagine the work that was put in by our ancestors to get people who couldn't even read the word, period. These people can read. I mean, they don't read statuses. They just look for stuff. They look for those key points. Sometimes they get it right. Sometimes they don't. You know what I mean? But in this case, we're going to get it right for them by highlighting it. That's if I'm teaching somebody how to read. And I'm only going to teach them probably how to read something that is relatable to them.
Mm-hmm.
So they can enjoy the process. So they were like, what next? Nope. You know what I'm saying? This is what we need in order. Oh, man, you know, you got to make it relatable. People don't even listen to their parents these days. Sometimes they join gangs. They go to join people or be with people that seems relatable to them. So we can't keep doing the same old things expecting some positive results. We got to get jiggy with it. You know what I'm saying? Right? We gotta be creative. We got to figure it out because we have the minds in order to do it. We have the minds. We can dig in and find something and checkmate them so that they will read. But we got to do some work. You know what I mean? We got to start, you know, building up some strategies, you know, kind of like setting them up to read. You know what I'm saying? Like checkmating them. You know what I mean? And it's possible. But that person got to have a little bit of desire.
And that's what was going to lead me to my next question, because therein lies the problem too. Because definitely one of the things that I see in the community is we aren't having the kids read. The kids aren't wanting to read, rather, because they're not seeing the adults around them read.
Yeah.
Or even with the task, trying to get the adults to even buy into these ideas that we're talking about. Okay, yeah, you know, we're going to highlight chapters and, you know, we're going to discuss that. So how do we get the adults? Because again, this podcast is not just focused on the kids. This is about community in general. You know, as you know, I mean, the same reading statistics that we got here in Cleveland is the same ones in Detroit. The same.
We read here in the deep.
Holly, you know what I'm saying? New York, where you go, it's going to be pretty much the same.
In terms
of either it's illiteracy, where folks are not able to read, or it's illiteracy, meaning they can read, but they're choosing not to read. So,
you know what? Can I say something? Which, don't lose your thought.
Okay.
I went back to college as a grown man. And I wanted to learn neuroscience. I didn't finish. I just went for a little while because I teach meditation. I teach the power of the mind. So I wanted to go and learn some more stuff. So I went back to college for fun. And everybody who was in my class, believe it or not, you would think that they were educated. Not. I was in one class in which we had to really comprehend something the way that it's supposed to be comprehended, right? Even I was wrong. I was way off. And everybody in my class was very, very young. You know, I'm grown as heck in this classroom, right? And everybody in there young. And it was a young lady sat next to me. I mean, she flunked that class. She had to be come back to it anyway, right? I used to, you know, joke with her sometimes, right? I say, you don't pay attention. I say, you keep flunking this class, you know? But anyway, we were all wrong. And that teacher taught us how a technique of how to properly comprehend something. He was saying that you have to really put yourself in the times of which that book was written. You can't read it from the times that you're in right now. Am I making sense?
Yes, you are.
This was years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, even as we go out to teach reading, some people just read.
Mm-hmm.
They don't even, and you ask them to articulate the story back to you, and they're like way off. You know, like I was teaching a class before and I would ask my students, I'm like, so what did you get from it? And it's like, you don't want to embarrass them. You're like, okay, that's really good. Even though they're like way off, right? That's a good perspective. I like that. But did you see this part?
Right.
I'm like, oh, man. You know what I'm saying? You'd be surprised at how many people who read and don't comprehend.
Yeah.
So this is a war, and in Islam we say the word jihad, and everybody think it means go, you know, beat somebody up. No, it's the jihad, a fight against yourself, right? And or another word I can use for it's like a reconstruction, you know, rebuilding of the self, because we built up ourselves through reading and don't even comprehend properly. So we gotta reconstruct, teach people how to comprehend. And once they become interested and they're really comprehend, and they say, hey, this book right here, I like this book. I understand exactly what he or she is saying. Oh my God. Now they're gonna keep reading because the brain is gonna be secreting certain dopamine. They're gonna be excited about what they're reading. So it's a lot of work to be done on this situation.
Oh, yeah.
So like, I don't know how to answer that previous question you asked, because so much work that needs to be done is like, oh my God. Like, where do we really start?
But you know what? Honestly, I think you did a great job with answering it because of the fact you focusing on the how, and then you even gave these examples in terms of the relatability piece. And even with, you know, just having the conversations and what it sounds like, and what we need to have more of in our communities is more book clubs, more activities that are centered around literacy, so that we can show those people who may struggle, because that's a big part of it too. While a lot of the kids are struggling, it's because the parents or the caregivers, they may struggle themselves. And so they look at it like, okay, you know what? Maybe I'm too old. You know what I'm saying? It's too late for me to try to really get better with my reading. So I'm going to make sure you don't become like me. But at the same time, you know, they're not understanding is that our children are not just doing what we say. They're doing what they see us do. Because we know in the Black community, that is something that a lot of us grew up hearing, you know what I'm saying? You do as I say, not as I do. And it's like, no, when we start getting more insight and understanding how this whole kid thing work, it's like, no, they learn by what they see. So if they see parents not really trying to engage in some type of text, even I've even suggested too, like I said, okay, you got your phone. All right, say you get on one of the news apps or whatever, and say, you know what, I'm gonna go pick an article that's interesting. Hey, look, you know, listen, check this out. Don't read the whole thing. Just maybe read a couple of sentences. You know, read a little, you know, like, crazy, what you think about that? You know, I've done stuff like that with my kids, you know what I'm saying? And just being creative, you know what I mean? Yeah. But I think, like you talked about, we have to show the people how, because in terms of just saying, well, you should do this, you should do that, but a person is still like, I don't know how, just like you explained with the comprehension piece. This teacher's trying to teach you all how comprehension works.
Exactly. You know, you said something about do as I say and not as I do, and it triggered something in my head, not trigger, but just brought something to my attention. That's how our brains work. Our brains work off, we mirror what we see, right? So when they see them doing it, they mirror it. And they've not made the room, they haven't made the room with inside in order to actually do what we're asking of them as far as to read, to expand their mind. They never made that space. So I think it's very important. That's why I wrote the book. Because it takes people inside of their head to show this is how this works within you. Your breathing, your posture, this all affects your being of who you are. So you're not gonna read you if you're if your neurotransmitters and all of this different stuff, you're eating the wrong food, those things are just, you know, going wild inside of there. No balance with inside of your head. Those people are not going to be able to sit down for 1 second. So to get them to read, we got to really, just like Allah got us to read. You get what I'm saying? He gave us self-development. And he said, "Ikra, read." It can't be read, right? And then vice versa, because you got to create the capsule or the structure for it to even sit in, right? Now, before you read, we need to get you to sit down. We need to get you to relax. I want you to breathe for a second. Before we read, we're going to breathe because we're going to slow down those brain waves, right? We're going to slow those brain waves. So before we read, we're going to do a meditation, just a breathing meditation. And they love that because they're having so much trauma in their heads. Their heart is beating so fast. They got so much going on in their head. And when you stop them before your session and say, "I just want you to breathe. Listen, forget this book. We're going to breathe. I thought we were here for a reading. No, we'll do that later. We're going to spend some time breathing. Now I'm creating the mold, right, in order to get this reading session popping, because I slow down those brain waves from a high beta, in which they should be in a high beta at this time of day. Long, I mean, if you're teaching them early in the morning, like if you're a school teacher and you're teaching kids straight out the bed, those kids are just coming out of an alpha brainwave state. They're sleepy. If you're teaching them at the end of the day, when they're ready to go home, they're at a high beta. They're ready to get the heaven out of there. So, you know, you want to bring those brainwaves down a little bit through some meditation. Then start, because here's the thing. None of us memorizes really anything except in an alpha and lower. We don't memorize really much in a high beta. You get what I'm saying? The brainwave's high. We're not memorizing anything. We're not able to keep in this information, right? We memorize on the low. So you want to bring them down to a low. Get them relaxed. Like you got me. And now we're going to start getting to read. And I bet you that will work.
That's actually, that is an excellent idea. I love that. This takes me back to, again, another idea that my sister, she had recommended. And she was talking about just telling parents on how to create that space of peace, mm-hmm. that space of tranquility, right? You know, mm-hmm. and just exactly how you explained it. And that is true. And that's something I've actually talked about before, you know, in my previous podcast, having a cozy, comfortable space when you're about to your children, because it's something that happens inside of our bodies, just like you explained, you know, it makes you be, you know, ready to receive information. It allows the state of, you know, you're not, you know, in a high stress state, you know what I'm saying? So
you're not trying to hear it in a high stress.
Exactly. So, I mean, right there, I mean, that is excellent. And we might as well stay right here on that path of your book, because I love that segue. I love how you brought that in. So we need to know, number one, when did you decide to even come up with the idea of writing this book, Meditate to Elevate?
So I don't want to stop me if I get too deep. First, I wrote a book called Think Your Life into Greatness. Right. And that book hasn't came out yet. So I gave that book to the editor and this book, Meditate to Elevate. I wrote it like 8 years ago. So I do life coaching. I teach meditation. So I'm teaching a class to answer your question about Meditate to Elevate. I'm teaching a class and it's full of women. And in this class, in this coaching session, many of these women were sexually abused. So as I'm helping and facilitating this class, I found that I was giving them knowledge, right? But I really wasn't solving the problem. I was just mating. I was just producing smarter sisters. Am I making sense? Is it a better way to say that?
So you weren't, you're saying you were just giving them knowledge. You weren't exactly
I
sure how they could.
I wasn't seeing a change. It was just like, you know, my purpose was to help healing, but I wasn't seeing healing. I was just seeing like, whoa, I gave her all this hip knowledge on how the brain works and how she can navigate life. But I wasn't seeing the change. So I talked to some of my coaches, and I had this one guy, he graduated from Harvard University. He studied neuroscience. He would come in and help me out. And it was amazing because he used to be one of their principals back in grade school. So he showed me some techniques to do. And I decided to go and take more classes on meditation. I was already doing meditation, but I wanted to take some more classes. And when I brought back meditation, change, right? I started to see change because now I'm not just giving you knowledge. I'm making you meditate in which you're able to hear thoughts in your mind. I'm separating you from the thoughts in your head. And I'm teaching you how to take notice of things that you never paid attention before. And these things that you're taking notice of, because you're in my meditation session, they're still playing in your head as you are moving. Once I learned the meditation components and started to teach the meditation aspect, I started to see changes in them. They started to feel better because, again, like I was saying, opposing to you hearing the thoughts that's playing in your head as you're moving about, right? Or how should I say it? Now that I'm teaching you how to take notice of thoughts in your head, when you're out and about, you're not paying attention, you know now that those thoughts are still playing. And they're making suggestions to you that you don't have to answer to. So wherever you're at, take this practice, center yourself, take notice of the chatter in your mind, decide the thoughts that you want to think about, right? So that's what made me really, really continue, you know, adding the meditation part and then write the book. Because once I start seeing how it was helping people so much, and of course it helped me, then I said, how can I get to more people? Right now I have, you know, 10 people, 5 people, students. How can I get to a ton of students, right? Where people who are out here suffering, hopefully readers, I can show them some of this information. They probably didn't even know that their thoughts weren't their own thoughts, right? Everybody thinks that these are my thoughts. No, they're not. Those are thoughts inherited to you by your ancestors or given to you by your ancestors, by your mama. Like you said earlier, do as I say. So you inherit these thoughts. These are not thoughts that you've chosen, right? And so you're doing things that's not even you, right? And so the more I'm like, hey, if I can put this down on paper and just teach some strategies and show some science-based facts, you know what I mean, and present this to them, I think that, you know, it will be very beneficial to the world, whoever grabs it. And not to go back to our previous conversation, but just a little bit, we were talking about how to help people. I believe in helping everybody, but helping people that want to be helped. So we're out. I'm going to come back to the book, but we're out teaching people the importance of reading, for example. How do we find the people that really want to read? who are seeking you, who are desperate to meet you. Why not go for those first? Then go back to the people who, you know what I mean, if we have time. So that's how I parallel this with my book, right? I'll go to the people that they really want this, but didn't know that it existed, right? They were searching. Those are the people that I hope to really, you know, show, hey, there's an answer to what you were looking for, right? Your thoughts are not your own. You can breathe and heal your body. You can breathe and change your thinking. You can relax, change your body structure, right? Totally change the way you feel and think, right? So this is what I, you know, what inspired me to really write it. Because I've, in my travels, I've noticed that a lot of people don't even know about it. Even the people who call themselves life coaches. I was sitting with a life coach one day, and the life coach was being a little rude, right? But I was like, it's okay, right? They're being a little rude. But I don't remember exactly what I brought up, but I brought up something on the, you know, and it was a neuroscientific perspective, but I knew they'd understand. But I really brought it up. They didn't know. I really set them up, right? So when I said it to them, because I knew they'll get it, you know, I pretend I'm talking about somebody else, right? They immediately came into tears, but tears of gratitude. They was like, that's me. You know, I play like, oh my God. Right? It was like, that's me. Right. That's my situation. So now I was able to bring the real out of them, and they appreciated it, right? So, you know, people live behind all of these masks. But again, back to the book, you know, I thought like, hey, this person didn't even know this. And they get paid. They're not a big life coach, but they're big enough. They're paying the rent. They're paying a new car note, and they're paying the house rent. They're looking good. They got, you know, 30 students or more. That's doing pretty decent. And they didn't know, you know, that, you know, how this mind works. And how meditation can actually heal the body and do all of these amazing things. So I said, what if I just write this? And before I write it, let me think about the people that I have taught or I've came across. Let me think about the leaders, the imams, and the pastors who didn't know, but they're ministering to these, you know, a massive amount of people. They don't know. They don't know. They think they know, and they don't know, right? Mm-hmm. What if I was to get this information to them, and a light bulb goes off? I was talking to my friend today and yesterday, who's going to help with the book, and she has NBA stars in her household, and as well as, this is what they do. They get funding. They get big funding from people like Google to do stuff that you're doing. So she's like, I got to get you in there because you have the perfect component when it talks about this meditation. So I looked at their platform, and it wasn't our people. It was more rich people, right, in those circles that's benefiting from that and not us. Mm-hmm. She said, I need to get you in there, right, because she's like, they don't know this. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so that's what the book has, just a lot of strategy. And I call the book just the appetizer. The book is 174-page appetizer. And it's, you know, to those whom it grabs, it's, I'm hoping that it will inspire them to go look deeper. You get what I'm saying? To go look deeper. You know, I have a lot of breathing exercises, a lot of meditations, and I share a little bit about, you know, for people who believe that meditation is for the Buddhist monks, and they believe that, oh, Muslims don't meditate, you know, although the Prophet Muhammad meditated. I was, these people be tripping, right? And I go into it to show them how in the, oh Lord, I can't think of the word, but it has to do with English, how you find meditation through our scriptures and through the scriptures of even Christianity. You know what I mean? So at first in the book, as I start the book off, after I explain a little bit about me, I go into that. Let's get this out the way. So you don't think that it's a religious thing. It can be for them, but it's not for everybody. It's about sitting straight up, shoulders back, bring them in close to your spine, be present, take the tenseness out of your body, and breathe.
So that's,
you get what I'm saying?
That's what I was going to ask that. Is that the definition of what meditation is, what you explained in terms, or is it?
I mean, that's one of the ways. And meditation is really just to be in focus. You know, like you can come to our museum and look at a piece of art, right? Mm-hmm. Instead of having Facebook, Instagram on your mind, you can look at a piece, stand there, and be present. That's also meditation. You can sit at the traffic light, and you know the traffic light is going to be 30 seconds. You can say, I'm not going to let my mind go all over the place. I'm going to keep my mind here right where I am, right? I'm not going to be thinking about it. I better hurry up. I got to get to this interview, right? I'm here, and I'm going to enjoy this moment. I'm going to focus on this moment right here and now. That's also meditation. Right.
So it's the same, because a lot of times we hear meditation and mindfulness.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. They're like used interchangeably. So is that?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So just being present, being focused in the moment, not.
Yeah, being focused.
Just worried about
all over the place.
Not, you know, being kind of going in a depressed state where you're just keep pondering over the past. You're just literally.
Being in the present.
Being in the present.
Because what happens is, if the brain, if you continue to ponder and live in the past, the brain is going to keep replaying this situation. It doesn't know the difference between real and fake. That's why you can watch a movie and you can be scared at some ketchup.
Mm.
You know, but it's not blood, that's ketchup. You know, this is the movie, this is Hollywood. Well, the brain doesn't know the difference. So you're playing old things in your subconscious mind, and you keep reliving it. So what's going to happen? It's going to secrete cortisol into your blood. Too much cortisol. I want some cortisol in my blood when I decide to walk across the street and a Mack truck is coming, and I was on my iPad walking across one of the major streets, and he blows the horn. I want that cortisol when he hits that horn. I want to jump out the way. But do I want it?
Cortisol is a stress hormone.
The stress hormone secretes from your brain into your blood, right? You need it, but you don't want it all the time, because if that continues to secrete into your blood, into your body, you begin to get sick. You're always stressed out, right? And then it becomes what happens. Physiology affects psychology. So this cortisol secreting into your blood affects your body negatively. And so y'all beat up and beat down. So it affects your reality. And which is your mind. Well, your reality, you know, it affects your mind. It then affects your reality, right? So if you can be present, sit properly, be in the moment, you can slow down the secretion of cortisol, you know, and which will help you become more creative, in which we talk about in the book. Because now you begin to see things. If I come and pull a gun out on you right now, you're not going to be able to think. You know, you're going to be like, oh my God, right? But if I have you relax, right, you're going to be able to think, you're going to be able to be creative, right? Have beautiful different thoughts. So meditation helps you become in that state. And not just to have creative thoughts, but just to be centered, just to be healthy. You don't want to be a slave to thoughts that are not even yours. that's creating damage. Like, what is it, a ping pong machine bouncing around in your body, causing you all kinds of sicknesses and illnesses? You can't think straight. You can't even drive right because your mind is all over the place, right? You can't even drive properly.
Yeah.
You're getting in an accident because you're stressed out. You got to jump in lanes because your anxiety is high. And anxiety as well is going to secrete that cortisol in your body. I want to be those things at the time that is needed, but I don't want to be like that all day long.
Your book is definitely needed, brother, because I'm going to tell you the things that you're talking about. Number one, it made me do a connection to Dr. Joy DeGruy's book that I reference very, very frequently, Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome. And she's the one where I heard her talk about cortisol in that way, you know, the stress hormone, and talking about how that's where you have a lot of our people in the community because of the post-traumatic slave syndrome. So we all, you know, it's always this, you know, you have a person, black person, they always ready for something to jump off, you know what I mean? Can't nothing, you know, what you say, you know what I'm saying? Ready to jump to the negative. You know, it's almost like we all have it, but some of us have it more than others due to their upbringing. So if you have an upbringing filled with trauma, and that's the thing why your book is needed, because a lot of our people, brother, a lot of our people don't want to sit still, because when you sit still, like you said, it makes you sit still with you have yourself. You have to connect with you. And so if you hate you because you were told that you were unworthy, you were not valued, then what happens? You like, I want to run away from me. That's why I have to stay busy. I got to always be in something. I can't sit still. I sit still, then now them thoughts are coming.
Right.
So
think about it. Go ahead.
So just to sum it up in terms of, again, why, you know, alhamdulillah, praises due to God that you actually came up with this concept of coming up with this book, because this is something that's needed. It is for those who want it. I like how you said that as well earlier in the conversation. We have to start with those who want to read, who see that, yes, I need to read more. This is going to be empowering. This is going to help me. Because those who don't want it yet, that might become like a difficult task, a difficult feat. So we always
it hinders your mission.
Yeah. Exactly. So, you know, again, you know, I mean, all of these jewels and nuggets that you drop in here on this episode is, this is what our community needs. This is what we are thirsty for. We need that. Yeah. So I'm glad that you touched on all of that. What I did want to ask you as well, I know we're coming up, you know, close to a close. I wanted to ask you how can we implement in terms of to the community, explaining the benefits of how reading is something that we need. I mean, because I think when people hear, okay, you need to read. A lot of times folks are like, well, why? Why is it that, you know what I'm saying, I need to read? I can actually, you have people who are like, hey, look, you know, I don't really need to read. I can go Google now, different stuff. Right. I can say, you know, hey, Siri, you know what I'm saying? You know, tell me this, give me that, you know what I'm saying? Information or whatever. I don't have to go and read it and research it for myself. So what are some things in which, you know, give me like three things that you would tell a person, you know what I'm saying, who literally is it three too much? No, three sooner, you know what I'm saying? You know, three things that you would say to like, okay, this is what reading does for you. Me and you, we know that. A lot of people listen. Yeah. But those who really, they're trying to figure it out. How is reading going to help them with their situation?
Well, one, I think I said it, make it relatable to that person. Tell me if I'm answering the question properly. Okay. If I'm not, make it relatable to them specifically.
Yes.
And, you know, these books have to be, you know, let me give you an example. People go to prison. And when they go to prison, you know what they do? They read. They read.
Mm-hmm.
They read in prison, right? Because they don't have those other things stimulating them in order to take their attention away. That's why the mindfulness is important. We don't want that taking their attention away, right? So, again, things that's relatable, books that's relatable to them.
Mm-hmm.
Oh boy, that's a rough, tough question.
Even in terms of like, because my thoughts is this, right? So you have, say, I'm gonna create the avatar. You have the single mom who, you know, she's got two jobs. I don't have time to. How can that reading? You want me to read so much? Tell me, you know what I'm saying? Give me the nuggets. How is it going to help me with my situation?
Of course. I mean, all knowledge is in the book. Another technique they can do is by putting, I did this, I would write paragraphs down out of the book, and I would patch it all through my house. Because again, if we deal with this through how the brain actually works, we could, we could try that technique using, again, how the brain works, by putting, plastering things in their face. First of all, we can't help nobody who don't want to help themselves. We don't have the time to wait. But for those who want to do it, we can start by, hey, I want you to take 25. I don't care what your house looks like, how pretty your walls are. We're going to tape this stuff all throughout your home. Different motivational paragraphs, right? You know, excerpts all through the house, right? That relatable to you, relatable to my daughter, relatable to my son, in the bathroom, all over the place. I did this in my home as a grown man. That's why it's called the Motivational Museum. That I am the Motivational Museum, although I do have that building, but that's how it started. I wasn't motivated all the time, but I put those things throughout my house, so I'm forcing myself to see them every day. So I had to read them every day. Now I have to memorize, right? And now, today, when I get into a situation, I may can't remember everything now, but if I get into a situation, it comes right back to my to what we call the frontal lobes, the frontal part of your brain. Right into my consciousness, right into my memory. Now I can share it, depending upon the situation I'm in. That's another way we can tell them, you know, reading, those things that you read will come help you in moments that you didn't expect, right? So putting those, you know, what will we call them that we're going to tape around the walls of the house? Pieces of paper.
Yeah, you could say, you know, motivational notes, you know.
Some notes that we'll plaster up around the house, you know. So you do that. Other people, like we said, we would just highlight certain stuff. To younger people, we'll tell about actors. We will go and find, like in my book, I found people like Oprah Winfrey, Michael Jordan. These are people that they know. The one that died, what was his name? The basketball player that died?
Kobe Bryant.
These were meditators because their coach's wife meditated. And, you know, so they, you know, these people were meditators, you know, they or studied psychology.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they're able to manipulate their bodies and do the things that they do, because they know how to be in a state of mindfulness. You know, you can't, you know, a way that we can teach them is to show them you can't run any business that you may want. You know, you ask them, like, what's your dream? Well, I want to do this. Find people that are readers, big writers in the field that they want to be in, and let them know you can't do it without doing it. This man that you see, that you want to be a movie star? Okay, awesome. Do you know how to read that screen? What's that screen called? I got one sitting right over there. Don't know the name of it. What is it called? The news read it all the time. They read off the prompt. Teleprompter.
Yeah, teleprompter.
You want to be a movie star? Yes. Get them all excited. Well, you got to know how to read. Mm-hmm. See, they don't know that. And you get them like, I just thought about something when I was talking to you. I had a reading circle. I used to do a reading circle at the mall. And, you know, it's like, okay, your turn. And then you be sitting there, you know, you're like, oh, my. I never knew he couldn't read. You know what I mean? Grown men couldn't read. It was like, oops.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You know, so, you know, it's important to learn how to read. So I said the thing, putting the cards around the house. Did I get my three? Please tell me I got my three.
You said make it relatable, of course, to that person, getting, you know, reminding them about different books, offering them different books that's relatable. You also, that writing the passages all through the house. I think that was the first time that I've ever heard somebody say something like that on the show. That right there, that is a straight up nugget. That's a straight up gem. I love that one. And then you talked about, you said how reading, of course, helps with in moments, you know, when a person, they actually like need that. Highlighting passages, that's what you also talked about.
Yeah.
The highlighting of the passage.
And my fourth one, so I went over and beyond. My fourth one, I would say again is, you know, if you're talking to any child that wants to be a rapper, because everybody want to rap, everybody want to sing, and everybody wants to be a movie star. So do you want to be a movie star? Yes, I would love to be a movie star. Well, you know you have to know how to read. Or you have to have an audience. Or somebody going to read it to you? You going to memorize it all?
You got to read them.
You got to know.
Memorize them scripts. I was in plays, so I remember how that was. Yes, you got to not only memorize your line, you got to know what the person is saying before you, what they saying.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
It's funny you said that. If you watch, one of Bob Marley's sons, maybe two of his sons are doing concert shows right now. Mm-hmm. And they both did their lines. Like, you should have this commercial coming down your, maybe you do, maybe you don't, coming down your timeline. Mm-hmm. Well, they're both singing the song that they're going to be singing at the concert.
Okay.
You can look at the face of one of the Marleys. Don't quote me, people, because I don't know if they're both Marleys. I know one of them is one. He recognized that the other one said the wrong song line. Mm-hmm. So you could see his facial expression change as his partner was singing the song. And then they both bust out laughing. So just, you know, to go off what you said, you got to know the lines, not just yours, but the other person. You know what I mean? You got to know the lines. So if you want to be a movie star, you got to know how to read. You want to do business, you got to know how to read. So it's okay to learn in baby steps.
Yep.
And let them know that there's things that we can't comprehend. There's books out here that we can't comprehend.
Mm-hmm.
So let me teach how to break words down.
Mm.
And then it's not really about reading the whole book. It's about breaking the page down. I can break it like when I read the Quran, our religious book, for example. Most of the Muslims, they read the whole Quran in Ramadan. I don't do that anymore. Mm-hmm. I'm breaking that page down.
Mm-hmm.
I'm breaking that page down. So I'm going to have more than you who've read it all day, because I'm going to be able to talk about, you know, go in depth about some things that you can't. So teach them that's so fun, and hopefully it is for them, how to break those words down. Just do that. Don't read the whole book. And you know eventually they're going to read the whole book, right? So it's like, don't read the whole book. Just break these pages down.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when I first came to the mosque, I saw people who weren't reading. Like, I saw the adults, but they had their kids around. That wasn't reading. And I came from a reading house. So one of the first things that I did when I walked in the mosque, you know what it was? You remember those dictionaries back in the day that were that big?
Mm-hmm.
I brought a dictionary and I took a chance. I could have gotten in trouble. and I snuck it to their kid, and I whispered to them, go study this dictionary. Just study the dictionary. Today, one of their children, he became an award-winning rapper because his verses, the way he talk, right? But I remind him, not all the time, but every once in a while, I say, remember I gave you that dictionary? He was a little kid. And the parents could have been offended. But I was like, I don't care. You know, I didn't care. But I was like,
I know what you're saying. Oh. You took a calculated risk. You said, okay.
I took a calculated risk.
Right.
I give him that big dictionary. Mm-hmm. So, man, when you're chilling, just bust through it. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Bust through that dictionary. And he did. I can't even keep up with him now. I have to be like, what did you say? Mm-hmm. Let me Google that real quick. You know what I'm saying?
The best rappers. It's like I just finished reading that book by Black Thought, his memoir. And he talked about that. He was like, he was studying and reading. He's like, that's how he was able to get his lyrics. Our brother, the Rakim, you know, talked about that as well, you know, coming from, you know, reading, studying and all of that type of stuff. So, I mean, the best rappers will let you know they're forever reading and writing the thoughts down.
Oh, you got to be able to write those thoughts so you can hold your phone and read it. How you doing? So if you're not that good at it, it's okay. Mm-hmm. Another thing I just will remind them is that it's okay, because if you start now, right? Mm-hmm. Just imagine us, we're grown. We learned these words a long time ago. Some of them we forgot the proper meaning. We probably misuse words. I probably misuse 10 words on this podcast.
Okay, I know. It's a grown person.
But for them, you can show them you'll have the upper hand over me, because I'm not sitting down re-studying the definition of words that I've been abusing and misusing. And somebody I've been talking to looked at me like, what? Okay. Maybe they made a mistake with that word, because that show was not viewed in the proper way, right? So you have the ups on me, and that makes it exciting. If you go and just start studying the word, man, who could touch you? Imagine what you'll be like in 1 year. I'm going to have to sit you down like, hey, you're getting beyond yourself,
right?
Right? Getting a little beyond yourself. Thank you, Malcolm X. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, and make it exciting for them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my 2 cents. I hope you edit me, because I'll be all over the place.
I don't do that much editing, because again, this is, again, real.
I'm joking.
It's like, yeah. Many times I didn't stumble and I'm like, whatever.
Yeah. Yep. This is the real.
For real. So, yeah. You and I, brother, you know, this is one of my favorite conversations, talking about reading, literacy, empowering our people, empowering our community. So I know we could go on and on forever, but I am going to have to bring it to a close. And how I'm going to close it is by this. You need to tell the audience what book you either are currently reading or you just finished reading.
Oh, my God. You, they won't believe it. They won't believe it.
What?
Number one,
uh-huh.
Seducing Strangers.
Wait, what is it? What is it again?
Seducing Strangers.
You said producing?
Seducing Strangers. It just teaches you, it's just about marketing. You know, having the new gallery and, you know, selling art pieces. And I'm always into sales with my businesses. It just teaches you how to communicate with people, right? And get them to buy. So this is a very, very good book. I really like this book.
Okay.
You know, again, it's about how to get people to buy what you're selling.
Okay, love it.
This book I read a long time ago. I was not a fan of this book. Okay. I was not a fan. I love the author, but I'm not all the way a fan, but I'm reading it again.
Okay.
It's a classic. Power by Robert Greene.
And who is the author? Robert?
Robert Greene? You don't know Power?
No, I don't.
I got to talk to you when we get off this line. This is the book, listen, this is the book that most young people read. They've all read this. You see how big this book is? This book is.
Really?
Over. This is the book that they've read. That you start communicating this book to people, young people, especially ones that had a hard time in life that may have been a kid. They all read it in college. They read this book. Robert Greene, you have to follow him on Instagram because he's starting to make reels now. 50 Cent wrote a book with him called The 50th Law of Power.
Is that why he came up with the show Power? Probably. Did he come up with that show? Am I right? That show
Power? I don't know, but I know that this is the 48th Law of Power. He wrote the 50th Law of Power, and he got it from Robert Greene.
Okay.
Wow. Yes. So it teaches you a lot of strategies. So that's why they read it, because it's similar to this book, Seducing Strangers. Mm. It teaches you how to deal with people. I mean, like, if I just randomly open it, let's see, give you an example.
Yeah.
It teaches you. Okay, come on. Okay, here's one.
Okay.
Use absence to increase respect and honor. Use absence to increase respect and honor. So he's going to go into a lot of way back into history, how somebody did it, and he's going to teach you how to master it. The book, the reason why I said I have a love-hate relationship with it, because it can seem manipulative, but it is not. He wrote it with good intentions, right? Some people may use it. They barred this book in almost all prisons.
Oh, okay.
They barred it in all prisons because he gives you the ups on your thinking, on your strategies. So I look at this book like a book of strategies. Mm. Here goes another chapter called Keep Your Hands Clean, right? Mm. And this chapter is, man, it's a good, good, great book.
Okay.
It's a good book. This Discovering Man. It's just teaching you strategies.
Okay.
Very, very good. So I'm re-going through that book right now because I haven't read it in a long time because I'm with a new mindset. So I want to see now, where am I at mentally? How do I interpret that book today?
Okay.
Right from when I read it a while ago. Especially after watching Robert Greene so much on his reels. Let me go back and take a look at that book, right? And I see his intentions behind it. He was missing. Don't.
Uh-oh, hopefully he doesn't.
Stop.
Okay.
Yeah.
Say that last part. Can you hear me?
Oh, okay.
Can you hear me? Okay. So
yes.
Okay, so repeat that last part you talked about. So watch his reel. Mm-hmm.
He wrote books to help people up to times, right? Teaching you. So he wrote this book from a good place. Makes sense.
Okay. We heard you say that part. He wrote the book from a good place. So I got that part there. I think that's a sign. We was already coming up on the close, but I'm like, look, I wanted to close.
There we go. So that's you. That's your phone.
I saw. I'm like, is that my janky internet? Oh man.
Thank you, God. I was so embarrassed.
That was my fault that time. Now the first time it was your fault.
So we even.
No problem. Well, look, this was a fantastic, dope, phenomenal, all of that conversation. I really appreciate you tremendously. I mean, the jewels and nuggets, dimes, gems, all that you was dropping, the community is definitely going to benefit. I always say this to my people, make sure when you listen to Real Reading Talk, because this is this podcast that's about empowerment, make sure you have your notebook and your pen, pencil, whatever you choose to write with, because you need to be taking notes. And if you need to listen to it again, which a lot of times people need to do that, just like with reading, just like what you said with that book, Power, you're going to reread. That's something that the educator, Dr. Greg Carr, talks about. He's a professor at Howard University. And he talks about how reading happens when you reread. That's when you actually are able to digest, able to get and comprehend. So making sure that we are, you know, impressing that. So it's okay if you have to reread, because you're going to get more of what it is that you need, a better understanding, better insight in what it was that you read. So I appreciate you. We appreciate you. Can you please tell everybody where they can find you so they can follow you, and also when your book is going to be ready for sale?
The book will be ready for sale. We will have a book release at the Motivational Museum located here in our city. You'll be able to buy the book, unfortunately, on Amazon. We prefer you buying it from our website at themotivationalmuseum.com. Themotivationalmuseum.com. Colossal_poetry_lounge. Colossal_poetry_lounge. And I think Facebook is Khalil Muhammad. Yes, ma'am. Oh, and TikTok is at Khalil Heels. K-H-A-L-I-L Heels. H-E-A-L-S.
Okay, so what I'm going to do, of course, I'm going to have you give me, you know, your different social media handles and the different places they can find you. And I'm going to put it in the description, so that, you know, when they're able, when they listen to the podcast, they go on YouTube, it'll be on all the podcast platforms, Google Podcasts, Apple, Spotify, and also on YouTube, then they'll be able to see. So you guys can just look right there and you guys can see where this brother is, because anytime I have any guests on here, trust and believe, I'm making sure that these are guests that you want to be following. You want to see what they're doing, because these are people who are helping the community. So again, once again, Brother Khalil Muhammad, author of title?
Meditate to Elevate.
That's right. Make sure that you follow him, you guys. I appreciate you tremendously. Thank you so much. This was awesome.
You too. Take care.
Yes. So once again, this has been another episode of Real Reading Talk. And please remember, you guys, to make sure that you are reading for at least 30 minutes a day. And remember, reading is freedom. Take care. I'm Miss Sasha. Peace. Y'all know what it is. Oh, my goodness. That dynamic conversation. Those jewels and nuggets that were being dropped during this episode. Having that conversation with Brother Khalil was just absolutely fascinating, intriguing. I loved, of course, how he talked about his upbringing, the reading background, the closeness of his family, and just, you know, talking about all the different things that led up to him writing his book that will be released soon. So I really felt it was a treat, and I hope that you guys felt the same way. And of course, you know, us having that conversation about how we can get our community to normalize reading again. Because yes, as we know, that was a part of our African roots. All right. And so my intent with having Real Reading Talk is to bring that back to life, bring that up to the surface. All right. So with all that being said, now I'm going to be going to my housekeeping, all right? So I just wanted to remind you all again, I am the founder and executive director of ABC Read, which is a 501c3 nonprofit organization. Our mission is to develop and nurture a culture of literacy in Black and underserved communities. We've given away over 6,000 books, y'all. We have dope, phenomenal reading events, all replete with read-alouds, interactive games, intergenerational participants there. So I'm talking about from the babies all the way to our wise folks. We have healthy foods, healthy snack options, because we want to, again, bring that rich culture of literacy into our communities and make it pleasurable, fun, exciting, engaging, inviting, and all of that great stuff. So you can actually go to our website, abcread.org, and please check out what we have been doing. And if you feel so compelled, if you feel moved, if you like looking at it like, man, they doing a damn thing, then please make sure that you click that donate button, all right? I'm also a pre-K to fourth grade reading tutor and a certified Orton Gillingham dyslexia tutor, all right? That's just, you know, some old fluffy stuff. I'm talking about how I can help folks who struggle with reading, okay? So please go to abclearntutoring.com, all right? Click on that free reading assessment today if your child is in need of some reading assistance. And make sure that you subscribe to my YouTube channel, Reading is Freedom, all right? I'm almost at the 1,000 subscribers, y'all. All right, 1,000 subs, okay? So y'all can help make that happen. Please make sure you do that. And if you are interested in buying them, the Reading is Freedom merchandise, please make sure you go to readingisfreedom.store. All right, prayerfully, that Reading is Freedom, that name will be trademarked. It'll be trademarked for me to put on sweatshirts as well as shirts. All right, so hoodies, sweatshirts, as well as regular tees. And yeah, so that's what's going on. And of course, I always like to make sure, and you can also catch this podcast, of course, on all the podcast platforms. Make sure I say that. So you can't, if you, you know, didn't go on YouTube, you can get on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, all right, all where you get podcasts at, okay? So yeah. And I want to share with you guys real quick about the book that I've been reading, The Coming. All right, I'm almost finished with The Coming, which is a novel written by Dr. Daniel Black. He is a professor, I believe, still in Clark, Atlanta, okay? And that book is a fictional novel in which he gives voice to our enslaved ancestors who dealt with the Ma'afa, which is the transatlantic slave trade. And he just talks about how these are things he was imagining that they would be saying to each other, the dialogue, the interactions that they were having while they were rudely and disgustingly interrupted by the false notion of white supremacy and kidnapped, all right, from their homelands, which is our ancestry homeland, Africa, all right? Excellent, excellent book. I highly recommend that you get it. There are parts in which you can just, you know, you can go to any part of the book and just read just certain parts and it'll just really, truly move you. All right. So there you have it. That's it for another episode of Real Reading Talk. That was episode, I believe, 25, 26. I should be keeping count. I have, but I forgot. And it's still season 3. Okay. I'm about to get ready to actually come up on a close on season 3 and prepare for the next venture, all right, season 4. So I'm trying to come up with some ideas. Maybe you guys can leave in the comment section on what are some ideas that you all have you would like to see Real Reading talk about for the next season. What should we focus on? I mean, we know the primary foundation of it, so where should I go with that? Should I have even more youth being interviewed on the podcast, which I've done. If you look in season 1, season 2, I've done that. So I want to go ahead and get ready, prepare for that. And I'm going to leave you all with the quote by Mr. LeVar Burton, which he says, "I think reading is a part of the human birthright." All right. I said that quote before. That's the quote that comes off the top of my head. And I said, you know what? I'm going to say it again. All right, so with that being said, y'all, I appreciate you all for rocking with me, and make sure that you all take care and remember, reading is freedom. My name is Miss Sasha, Real Reading Talk.